Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome back to the 1972 Olympic Games shooting range, where we're continuing the excitement of the day with double trap men. I'm Hillary Russell and have the pleasure of having USA's 2010 world champion Joshua Richmond with me today. Welcome, Josh, and thanks for joining us.
Hey, thanks, Hillary. It's my pleasure.
It's a pretty exciting day for Team USA, I have to say. We've got two of the team's finalists in here, and it's going to prove to be a very interesting competition, to say the least.
It is. It was a great day for double trap in a whole. I mean, watching all these shooters chase the world record was, you know, so much fun in itself. And watching somebody actually beat the world record was, you know, just astounding.
And that is really amazing. We've got some great scores. We've seen great scores in on the shotgun side here. We are here for rifle, pistol, and shotgun during this World Cup. But the shotgun scores have been just out of this world.
They have. I mean, there's a few variables that, you know, shotgun shooters love. Good targets, great weather, and, you know, of course, targets that break easily. And these targets that they prepared for us have just been one of a kind. And they, no one's having any issues with the flight patterns. The jury's doing a great job setting targets, and that's why you're seeing this kind of scores.
Why don't you give an idea to the folks at home that are watching what we can expect here? We've had a couple of rule changes from last year to this year. Would you mind going over that, Josh?
I'd be happy to. So basically, we've shot our pre-qualification rounds, and we've narrowed it down to the top six. And now what we're going to do is we're going to shoot one more round, just like we have in the qualification rounds. At the end of this round, we're going to look at the top scores. We're going to narrow it down with starting at the best hit or the most possible, you know, out of 30 targets down for the gold medal match, silver match, which will be the top two highest scores. And then the next two lowest scores will get to go into the bronze medal match, which will be the third and fourth place after this. In double trap, because scores are typically very high, we see a lot of shoot-offs, a lot of ties, which makes it very, very exciting. So I'm not doubting today that we're going to see some ties, some very heated shoot-offs to get into some of these medal matches, to even have a chance to win a medal after shooting world record scores.
You know, a lot of these gentlemen are going into the semifinal here. I've seen from the past, they get a look in their eye, and you can tell they're in a rhythm. And at that point, you could say, you know, if they're tied up with somebody else, we're definitely going into a shoot-off. There's no doubt about it. And then that shoot-off can also go on and on and on as well. And it just goes to show what incredible talent we have out there.
Exactly. One interesting thing with this particular squad is you have some shooters who maybe have been, this is their first World Cup final. We have some shooters that have been Olympic medalists. So we have the top of the list down to the bottom, but they have all shot world-class, world record scores today. And it's anyone's game, obviously, at this point.
And this is another thing that we've been seeing over here at the shotgun range this week, is that the underdog, someone we've never seen before, coming into a final and going home with the gold medal. So, you know, I think that sometimes with these new finals that we have, some of these young people, they've never shot the old way before. And so they know only this format, and it works for them.
That's correct. You know, it's interesting because, I mean, I don't consider anybody an underdog, even though some of these guys haven't shot finals. But you're looking at all these guys had a chance to break the world record today.
Right.
So coming from this range and, you know, looking at these guys getting into their first final, shooting such a high score, it's really amazing.
Now, there is one change or a couple changes from last year. Instead of doing the semifinal going from stations 2, 3, and 4, we're going to be going through station 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And then when we get into the medal matches, then we'll be doing stations 2, 3, 4.
Exactly. So these finals are exactly like two different games in itself. So we're going to basically start over just where we were at from the pre-qualification rounds. All shooters are at zero. After we introduce the gold medal and bronze medal matches, we start a completely different format.
That's right. And we're going to have a chance to meet our six finalists. Here they are, all lined up in a row. Some of the faces we know very well. Some of them we haven't seen before.
To the Olympic shooting range in München, Hochbruck. My name is Shaq, and it is an honor to host your Double Trap Men's event today. Before I introduce the athletes, can I remind you that all bib numbers have been distributed at random?
This is also a new thing that they've been doing, is about the bib numbers.
They have, yeah, they randomly distribute bib numbers at random. So you may have come in, in this case, breaking the world record. You may have come in last place in the final, and you don't know what position you're going to start in. And that can either hinder or, you know, help you in some situations. You know, obviously, being in positions 4 and 5 on the squad, you can have an advantage by seeing so many targets.
So in position 1, representing the Russian Federation, we've got Vasily Mosin.
Yeah, Vosley's a really tough contender. He's always up at the top.
In position two, representing Great Britain, we have Tim Neal.
And this is our world record setter today. You know, it says here he's, you know, he's making his first final, but he shot a world record. He definitely deserves it.
In position three, representing the United States of America, we've got Walton Eller.
And Glenn Eller, one of my best friends. I mean, trained together, worked together. He's won every medal in double trap that's out there. He's definitely going to be a contender in this final.
And in position four, representing Slovakia, we have Hubert Olenek.
And this is a new face for me. I noticed looking at his resume, we shot together in Lonato and Nicosia. And he again qualified with the right score to get into this final. So I'm anxious to see how he does in this new format.
And position five, representing the People's Republic of China, we've got Wang Hao.
Wang has had some success, you know, coming from China, and you can never turn your back on any of these Chinese shooters.
Absolutely not.
They study the game, and they show up, and they usually mean business.
And in position six, our second gentleman from the United States of America, we've got Jeffrey Holguin.
And I'm extremely proud for my shot off with him in Tucson, Arizona, for him earning his first World Cup gold. And I hope him well in this one as well. Maybe he can secure another one. It'd be a great year for him.
That's what we were just talking about before we got on air, is that, you know, if Walton Eller could get a medal today, that would mean all three of you.
It would. Yeah, I have had a good year myself. Struggled a little bit today, but I'm really proud of my teammates and, in fact, all the shooters today. Which I'm many friends with. We've met Germany. A lot of the shooters here. It's going to be interesting to see this final, but it would be very
Ladies
special to see, you know, Walton win another medal. Not that he needs one, because he's got a bunch.
But, where does he put them all, huh? Where do you put them all?
He's got a bunch of them, but I'm interested to see what happens. I don't know if the U.S. has ever come away with a full national team ever winning a World Cup and all the medals. So, but we'll see as all the countries bat. They're going to have to earn it. These shooters are tough, and they're going to definitely have to earn their medal today, whoever wins.
Now we're starting off this semifinal. It's 6 o'clock p.m. The light is still very bright out. But as we've noticed in the past few days here, there's a certain point where things kind of get a little bit darker. Not dark by any means, but luckily today we don't have any of those really thin white clouds.
We don't. As you can tell on your monitors at home, we're dealing with a clear blue sky. This reminds me a lot of where I was at in 2010 coming into the World Championship Final. We had a little rainstorm that passed, and then it just opened up. It was very calm, a little bit of a headwind, which is what I feel from up here in the booth, that may or may not become an issue. A lot of when we have a headwind, a lot of our targets go a little bit higher, but dealing that with this wall and this stadium, you know, seating behind us, the wind could swirl down there, and I don't know what they're going to deal with down there, but we'll soon see how they're going to make adjustments and how these targets are going to fly.
And in fact, we have been feeling and losing papers up here from these gusts of wind that have been coming through. So I'm not sure if it's really going to hinder them. We'll just have to find out and see how it goes for them.
We'll see. You know, I know in Tucson we had a lot of wind, and it was whoever could adjust the quickest was the victor. And thankfully it was me, myself, and Holguin, but we had a lot of shooters that struggled with the adjustments. The targets were doing some different things.
There's one other thing that has changed this year, and that is preparation time. Do you want to go over that?
Yeah, the preparation time, you know, typically double trap goes pretty fast, but it does play a role. We have, I believe it's 12 seconds per shot. So, you know, when a guy to our left, which we're watching Vasily Mosin get ready to shoot here, after he completes his shot, the guy to his right will have 12 seconds to shoot. And the judges are watching this, and they're very, very strict about it.
And that's true. If by chance you go over that time limit, you get a warning at first. If anything happens after that, then you get zero.
That is correct. And not only is it a warning, but it messes up with your routine a little bit. Oh. You kind of come out of your you know, mindset. And as we watch both shooters start off with two perfect pairs, but it's something to keep on your mind. Yeah, you know, if you're a shooter that takes a little more time, you got to be conscious of that time limit.
And it seems as though most of the shooters out there that I've talked to are happy with this, that they're really beginning to nail it down, because, well, especially the faster shooters.
They are. In double trap, we shoot one day. We're in and we're out of competitions. You know, we shoot very fast. Our normal round takes us about 11 minutes to complete with a six-man squad. And so we're not one to go out there and take a whole lot of time.
On now to Wang Hao. Like his first miss there, it looks like.
Yeah, we're waiting to see the judges score that, and they had scored it as a double hit. From the booth, it was a little bit hard to see, but he had looked over at the refs to confirm, so there was two visible puffs of smoke, which is all we need here in this final round with the targets. That one looked like a first bird miss out of our USA shooter, Holguin, as he looked out on the field to make sure there wasn't any visible powder.
What?
Let's just talk for a second, Joshua, about this shooting range. What are your thoughts on it?
Well, this is a beautiful range. You know, what's cool about it is it's very consistent from the first range all the way down to the last. Typically, some of the countries we go to, because of the size of ranges we need, it doesn't always work out that we're all on the same level or same background. But this one is in itself really unique, as well as the age of this. I mean, this is an Olympic range from 1972 Olympics. It is
amazing. It's upkeep.
It is. It's the upkeep and just the history of it to be able to come out here and shoot and look back on things like that. To be able to stand the same spots that some of our Olympic champions have stood. It's really unique. It appears as our finalists are having no issues with these targets as far. Our friend from Slovakia had just missed another first bird, which is a little bit different. You know, typically in the finals, we miss second birds.
Mm-hmm.
So there may be a little hole point issue. Maybe he didn't see the first bird come out quite well enough. But the majority of the finalists are chucking right along.
And that is a miss for Wong. Can you explain to the viewers why it would be that you would generally miss the second bird?
Well, the second bird we have to point out a little bit more than the first bird. The first bird we use a little more of a spot shooting technique or a push. We typically hold a higher hole point. We know where it's coming from. Although with this new rule change, you know, having random targets, the first pass as a double trap shooter, we don't know what we're going to get. So we're kind of using our eyes more so than we normally do, just trying to figure out what pair we actually have drawn.
Okay.
So whether we got the A, the B, or the C. Once we decide that and we shoot our first pass, we can narrow those down to at least our first bird.
Oh.
But up until that point, these shotgunners are going in actually blind, you know, hoping that they draw the one they're holding for, and if not, they have to make a really big move to the other side of the field for their pair.
Alert.
As you can see there, he just drew that off bird. He made that huge move on that first bird to come over there.
Stop.
Successfully hitting the pair. Judging by the scores today, I'm willing to bet there's going to be a perfect score, if not two or three in the final. It's going to be interesting to see what we have here at the end. There's just never is there a time where you see 145, 146s and above make the final.
I know.
It's just unheard of.
Unheard of is right. This is what the whole talk was about, trap, both for the women and men's events, too. I mean, the in order to get into the final, they said, after qualifications, that's impossible. You never see that. You can usually get in with a much lower score, but not this week. I'll tell you, these guys are really on fire.
And I just watched Jeffrey Holguin miss another one. That's an off pair on C. We call it the off pair. He was holding for trap 9. He had to move the trap 7 and 8 for his targets. And actually... Okay, Vasily Mosins is taking an extra deep breath there. I didn't know if they had seen some smoke or if it was a no bird. But he had to make the big move on that trap 8 target, which is the center machine.
What?
Which sometimes messes you up for the second one. And we see Vasily miss the first bird.
On now to Neil.
And Neil has that world record still going strong.
He sure does,
straight.
Isn't he?
Tough shooter. I've seen Neil at quite a few World Cups, but this is, I mean, he has stood out at this one. He has been solid, solid all day long. Definitely one to watch.
Yeah, he's never made it into a final round of a World Cup. He's, the closest he got was last year in Nicosia, where he plays 10th. But, you know, something must have been going on since then and now, obviously.
Absolutely. yeah, he's doing something different because he's made a name for himself today. You know, not only breaking the world record, but definitely showing up in the final meaning business. There was another off pair, as you can see, that really big aggressive move on that first bird. Making him, you know, unfortunately missing that second target there. It's just, that's one of the new aspects of our game that a lot of these shooters aren't used to, is that really dramatic move into the first or second bird. We have so much gun speed moving over to somewhat still targets. You have to be able to control it and hold on to the targets.
Let's go back onto Mosin now, shooting a perfect semifinal up until now.
What?
He's really
Yeah, and actually, Hillary, going back to that, looking at the score, they had given him that last bird. I wasn't able to see from the booth, but he has a perfect score as far as the scorebird is concerned. And I saw him look at that one as well. He barely nicked that one. So he still running clean.
Good. Also, Neil.
Yeah, Neil's hits are right in the center. I mean, he's drawing a lot of smoke, busting these targets right in the center. So he's definitely comfortable in his stance right now. As well as Glenn Eller, he's also looking very strong. You know, we're looking at the first pass being done right now, so a lot of these athletes are not they're not able to give up at this point, but they have a little bit of a sigh of relief knowing that their first targets are understood from this point on.
Right.
They don't know what pair they're getting, but they know where their first targets are coming from.
So that was a double. He missed both of those before. I thought that's what I saw, and then on the scoreboard it seemed a little bit different.
He did.
That's kind of detrimental when that happens, you know?
It is, you know, and it's so hard sometimes for these judges to watch because, you know, guys are shooting so quick, and the puffs are sometimes so faint, but they're all there, and they're doing the best they can, Hoagie and crushing that pair. So we have gotten them all the way through that first pass.
And let's just take a look at the standings after this first pass. We have Eller and Neil and Molson and Olenek all tied up with perfect scores. We've got Hoagie in fifth place and Wong in sixth with seven.
And just ahead of him, and behind the leading pack is Hoagie, who missed two.
Look at Hooban Yan right there, who shot a really great score over in Kazakhstan, where we just came from. Actually get in the final and missed out on a medal, but he went in leading the round.
No kidding.
So that shows you what kind of damage these finals can do to a person when you get in, and it's more or less a sprint to the end.
That's right.
And we look on the field now, which is something ironic. They're testing his ammo on post to Mr. Neil from Great Britain. So that's something that they have just started. Being able to test ammo during, they can pull them out of your shotgun, they can pull them out of your pockets. They can also look for counting devices and doubles. So they've added a few different things to our keeping it fair.
Mohsen absolutely on fire here. He's just, you know, had, ever since last year, winning the World Cup final, he just has been really in the groove.
He has, and Russia as a whole has always been strong. I know I've battled with Folkiev, the Mohsen, numerous times, and those guys are always top contenders. They're a lot of fun to talk to. They're very good competitors. They're fun to compete with, and they're very, very tough shooters.
Whoa!
I don't see any dust off that one. Looks like Glenn made a shot a little bit quick. He knows what he did, though, judging by the look on his face.
Right.
So I'm sure he won't let that one happen again. And that's another part of this, is once you know what target you're getting, it's easy to speed up or second guess it, or maybe start your move before the targets appear, which can be very, very bad for a double trap shooter. The timing is everything in this sport. So it's anxious to see, maybe, you know, not always knowing what target you're getting can not always help you. So we'll see what happens.
Now, you said that you have 12 seconds from when the person in front of you has shot. To shoot, call yours or to shoot? Yeah, to shoot.
Exactly, to call your target.
Yeah.
That's correct. Yeah, and there'll be a clock displayed on the field. It's not in front of these shooters, but it's going to be off to the right, and the ref will call it out. Like I said, I saw it in Tucson, I saw it in Kazakhstan.
Mm-hmm.
Typically, double trap shooters are close to that mark, but I would have to say the average is 7 to 9 seconds on these competitors out here on the field, so they're not getting close enough to the 12-second delay. But if something was to happen, you know, their eyes don't focus quite right, a bug comes into play, and they stop down a couple, few more times than two, they may get called out on.
Right.
What?
Mohsen making it look very easy here.
He is, and you can tell his speed has picked up a little bit. He knows exactly where his first bird is. He's you know, hitting it dead on the spot on the first shot, realizing where his second target is.
Also, Neil's.
Very good shot of Neil. You know, you see him holding really high right there, but he pointed it out perfectly. For being in his first final, he looks very calm.
He does. And that's another thing that we've seen this week. There are these, you know, new faces that we haven't really seen enter into the semifinal or, you know, a final round of a World Cup. And, you know, some people say it's because they can just think, well, what do I have to lose?
Right.
You know, I've made it into the semifinal, and that's great for me. But that kind of then carries over. All of a sudden, they're in the gold medal match, and they also probably think, what do I have to lose? I'm going to win the medal, either the gold or the silver.
Exactly, and that's one of the benefits of being in a gold medal round is you're guaranteed a medal.
Yeah.
So you know you're going home with something. Oh. Not that it takes any of the pressure off if you haven't won a World Cup yet or not, but that's something to think about in the back of your head. At least you've accomplished something. But in looking at today, I mean, every score out here you need to be proud of. I mean, if you shoot that score 9 times out of 10, you're going to win a medal or come out of the day far ahead of your competitors.
What?
Nice.
Yeah, going back to Mosin.
Yeah.
And, you know him from competing next to him, he does dance around a lot on the station. He likes to, you know, after he's shot, he, you know, kind of has a breath of confidence goes over him. His mental game is at his top. Spoke with him earlier. He said, you know, there's only one person you have to beat out here today, and that's yourself.
That's right.
You know, when you think about it that way, it does simplify this game a little bit, which may be some of the reasons for a lot of his success.
But also, I think for him, just from talking to him, he's got such a positive mental stance to himself. You know, how are you doing? Everything is great. You know, and
you're right.
And you can tell everything really is great. And I think that when you're on top of your game, as you say, and are very positive and feeling confident, that certainly must help.
Absolutely.
Olenek is really doing a fantastic job as well.
He is, and I'm looking at this right now, and two of the guys that we haven't normally seen in finals are with perfect scores as of right now. So it's, like I said, these new finals formats are extremely interesting. Completely different mindset from the day. And what we've seen in the past is typically the guys going in with the most points or most hits have – faltered down just a little bit. You know, they have something to lose. They go in the lead, and now they have one more round they got to prove themselves on. And we've seen it in Tucson and Kazakhstan. But we're not seeing it here. The world record holder now, the new world record holder, and, the gentleman from Slovakia is just, killing all these pairs. But there are just some expertise in the final they're going to have to deal with.
Most
is still straight, and there's a few guys behind them that are knocking on doors. So we'll see what happens here in the end.
We've been starting our shotgun semifinals after 6 o'clock, around 6:30 or 6:45. And I thought, gosh, it's a really good idea that we started this at 6 o'clock tonight because we could be going into one shoot-off after another after another.
Well, I think it's important, too, to talk about the, our qualification rounds ended at 2:45 or 3 o'clock. So these athletes have literally had about a two-hour break.
Right.
So these guys have come off the line. They went and got something to eat. Some of them may have taken a quick nap or, went for a jog or something. But they had to come out here, and they have 30 targets to basically go after these medals after a two-hour break. And that alone sometimes coming out, we saw the start was just a bit rocky, but they have all found their rhythm and their groove right now. So that's just another variable they have to deal with.
Now, do you prefer, Josh, just to go from qualifications right into the finals?
I typically do, although, most of the matches I've been in, we've had longer breaks, so I've gotten somewhat attuned to that and just being able to get out of, your mental state, getting back into another one. So, when you're, as a competitor, if you throw it, we're going to try to break it.
Right.
these guys really don't matter. It just doesn't bother them so much. They're interested in a competition. They're interested in camaraderie. They're interested in who's going to wear these three medals that they're deciding right now over, through their necks in about another hour or so.
That's
so it's down and dirty right now. Yeah, because we're coming up on the, almost two passes into this. So at the end of this pass, if they have been counting or remembering, rather, they will know the exact pairs they're getting here at the end. So it's not one of those, you don't want to count your chickens before they hatch,
right,
but they know what's coming. So we'll see how they can handle the pressure.
Whoa!
Yeah, Allard just had that little hiccup there at the beginning of the second pass.
He did, and you just saw he shot that C setting right there backwards on post two, so he knew he was getting trapped. And he made that really good move to that first bird and had to move to the right to kill that second bird, which was great.
Oh.
Nice.
And what's interesting is, even Wang being three targets down, he really can't count himself out yet. You know, this last pass could wreak havoc on any one of these shooters. The wind, again, is still gusting, going around a little bit, not affecting the targets as much as I would think.
So after the second series here, we still do have a tie here, a three-way tie between Neil Mosin and Olenek. Perfect, perfect score so far. Eller's in fourth place. We've got Holguin in fifth place and Wang in sixth. Anything can happen. We still have five more sets.
We do. We have five more pairs.
Right, pairs.
You know, and one of the things you want to think about, too, is, you know, these guys are out in the sun. They have a cover here behind you, as you can see on your monitors and TVs back home. But these guys are out here in the sun right now. And although in the shade, his breeze feels pretty nice, these guys are feeling some heat out there. They've got to be warm by now. They have to stay focused. And this is their last pass.
Now, just a question for you, Josh. You know, generally, when you come to Munich, you just are ready to get yourself dressed pretty warmly because the weather is always chilly or rainy or what have you. We've had for the last three or four days downright beautiful sunny days, but hot. I mean, it's up in the high 80s, low 90s.
It is.
Is that affecting anybody? Because I've, you know, some of the people over in the finals hall for pistol, they were saying, you know, our hands are getting cold. We're not used to that. We weren't thinking about that.
Right, and absolutely. In the rifle, you know, in the finals hall for rifle and pistol, it is it's definitely a lot hotter. I watched the women's air rifle yesterday, and it was scorching inside. And granted, I'm in t-shirts, and actually we have our first miss now from Hubert from Slovakia. So as we go in our last pass, you know, like I said, anything can happen. So now we should have a two-way tie for the gold medal match.
Right.
And then we have a tie now for the bronze medal match as it stands. But, yes, as far as the climate here, you know, for shotgun shooters, it's great. You know, there's a little bit of a breeze, the sun, you know, there's no clouds, no rain. Rifle hall, it is extremely hot. They have, you know, the windows are open. They're doing their best to try to get it, climb a little bit lower. But it's just not helping them. And then on top of that, they wear the leathers.
Exactly.
They wear all this uniform stuff, which we do not have. We typically have a shell vest, a shooting vest, and you wear shorts, t-shirts, or pants if you'd like. And we see Mosin miss one. That is very.
You can tell he was not pleased with that.
He was not.
No.
He must have knew where his shot went there, because he had a look of he knew where that one went. Put it that way. But now we have Tim Neal reset. So as we come down to the final shots here, we're these athletes are taking a second, and we just saw the warning car go out for the time.
That's right.
So like I said, if you faltered a little bit, the refs are very adamant about this timeline.
Oh.
Well, and it didn't make a difference.
I was going to say, it does not affect him at all. So from here on out, if Neil gets another one of these, if he goes over the time limit, he will get zero for a score.
According to the rules, it will be zero after this.
Eller is totally back into the groove. He had that little hiccup in the middle, and he's right back on his game. Again, now on to Olenek. Good.
Perfect hit there. Hubert down one, Eller down one, and Mosin down one. That's going to be a three-way shoot-off as it stands for the gold medal match.
Right.
The two that don't qualify are still in the hunt as it stands, but the guys behind them are right now shooting their butts off to try to get into that shoot-off.
Ball!
Another perfect pair by Holguin leaves him one target out of that shoot-off right now.
What?
Nice.
Mosin definitely knew where those were going. That was very confident, very quick. Knew exactly what pair it is.
Oh.
This guy absolutely is unstoppable. Neil is shooting like a star.
I don't think I've seen him even chip a target.
I don't think so either.
Every target has been right in the center. He's very confident about shooting. Whoa. Pairs left. He's looking fine. Huber getting one pair closer to securing himself into a shoot-off for this medal round.
Oh. Wang's really made an amazing improvement from the first pass. He is just right into his game. Let's go back now on to Holguin.
Ball.
Great.
It looks like that target did skyrocket a little bit, that second bird. Maybe climbed an extra 2 feet or so, but he went up there perfectly for it. We have two pairs left.
What?
Until we decide this, and there's another one. that particular target from up here looked like it flattened out, and Mosin may have been a little bit aggressive going to that second target. There's a first miss from Neil, I believe. Actually, from up here in the booth, it was hard to see the powder, but the referees did not signal as a miss, so there must have been powder on the field. Another dead pair by Eller.
Olenek. One miss. Nice.
Yeah, as it stands right now, Eller and Mr. Hubert, they're going into a shoot-off to see who's going to face Neil for this gold medal round. But we have just under one pair left for all the shooters. And one pair is two birds. It can mean a lot.
That's true.
The way these guys are shooting.
Ball.
Right.
Mosin's in with a 28. If it all stands the way it does, that does secure Mosin into a shoot-off potentially for the bronze medal match if Holguin can score his last two hits. But right now we'll see if Neil, and he does. He qualifies himself for the gold medal round.
Round, yep.
So that world record is going to pay off with something to wear around his neck. That's really good shooting.
Ball.
Eller just secured himself into a shoot-off for the potential gold medal round. If not, he can fall back in for the bronze medal shoot-off.
Olenek also finished off with 29.
And that's great shooting for his first time in the final.
Unreal. Again, now on to Wong.
He's going to finish with a score of 27, which will unfortunately put him in a place of sixth, although he shot extremely well today.
Can you imagine that 27 sixth place.
Does not pay him off for the score he shot. Holguin with a 28, so we do have some shoot-offs.
This is great. This is going to be a long afternoon there, Joshua.
I knew it was going to be exciting. Like I said, double trap guys, these are all top-notch, world-class shooters. I knew it was going to be exciting.
Okay.
We'll let the judges tally it, and as you can see, there's five people in this shoot-off here, five shooters in this shoot-off.
Unfortunately, in sixth place, we've got Wang Hao from the People's Republic of China. Mosin and Holguin are going to be in a shoot-off together, and then we're going to do a shoot off for the gold medal match as well. And with these guys, these shoot offs can go on for quite a while.
They can, yeah, because from now on, we're going to look at the C setting pair for shoot offs.
Right.
And it's a missing out. So if we miss a target as a shooter, we're out of that round. So all that hard work we did today, everything that went on, one target now, one slip up, and we're out of a medal round. We have two particular medal rounds going on here. So we have Mosin and Holguin. They're going to fight to get into the bronze medal
Ladies
match.
And gentlemen,
and we have the three above them, which are going to fight to get into this gold medal round.
Right.
In the double trap men event from the People's Republic of China, Ho Wang.
So, Josh, tell me a little bit about you and what's going on in your life.
Well, you know, things have been good. I faltered here a little bit, but, you know, every once in a while a shooter has a bad day, and I'm okay with that. I had a really good year so far, these two World Cups, Tucson and Kazakhstan. I was able to secure silver medals. And, you know, I had a rebuilding year. After the Olympics, I kind of faltered a little bit with this new rule change. It was tough for a lot of these double trap shooters to switch over. Some didn't have any problem with it. You know, Eller and Mosin both, you know, came out of the gate just blazing,
right,
winning a lot the first year. It took me a solid year to really sit down and rebuild myself as far as a shooter and just come up with a completely different routine. And since then, I think it's worked pretty well. You know, I made this year's World Championship team.
Yeah.
Secured two medals. And, you know, Germany's been great to me. I won a gold medal here in 2007 and 2010 for the Worlds in front of my parents, which was great. But
I will never forget that, Josh. It was so great.
You know, some of those things you just wonder how and why they work out, but they do. And I remember shooting that day. It was it was a lot of work. I remember it being a lot of work, but it was a lot
Ladies
of fun in the end.
Yeah.
But things have been going great, and I'm really looking forward to taking myself, Holgeen, and Eller to the World Championships in Spain. I think it's going to be a great experience for us
in this
leading up to Rio. You know, all the double trap shooters, all the countries are shooting good. We've all learned the game. We're on that road back up. We're going to make it very exciting for the spectators, and we're looking to make a lot of drama, which is what we did here today. Shoot-offs, a lot of grudge matches. Of course, you know, it's all at a friendly competition, but these guys out here right now are shooting their butt, you know, their best they can to try to win these medals. And again, one little slip up here after coming all this way is the difference between taking a medal home and not.
Exactly.
So we see Mosen getting ready to shoot here, and that's another new rule change. There's no view pairs, no test firing. It's we're going right back on the line, we shoot.
What? This is real. I mean, these two men are. Everybody knows them. You
they
know,
do.
They're the cream of the crop.
This one has potential to go forever. I know these guys, I believe, hold the unofficial world record for the longest shoot-off. I think it was in Peru they went 50-some targets in a shoot-off.
Last year.
At the World Championships. So they've met before.
It was dark out by the
exactly.
time they finished it.
Yes. So that's, you know, we have a little bit of time right now before it gets dark out, but I'm not doubting their either one of these guys' abilities to do a shoot-off, you know, and that's one of the things, you know, looking at just having a C setting now, these guys can get grooved in, they can learn these hold points. Not viewing pairs won't be much of a matter right now because they're comfortable with these pairs. So this small sprint may turn into a marathon very fast. And not to mention, both these guys have had, you know, large success so far this year.
Yeah.
You know, Jeff Holgeen winning his first gold medal at the Tucson World Cup. And then, you know, Mosen not only being the medalist of the World Championships last year, but shooting off in Kazakhstan. I think he's secured fourth place. Tough competitor.
I think he won the bronze there.
Oh, you're right. I'm sorry.
Yeah,
you're right.
Good.
We had to wear those beautiful costumes. You're right.
How did that make you feel?
I know. You know, it was a lot of fun, actually.
Was it? Oh,
yeah.
Good.
We all looked at each other and we thought, do we get to keep these? And the president of that country said, yes. You know,
this is
our gift to you guys. So,
nice.
You know, it was kind of an inside joke at first, but we all took them. It was a really neat parting gift. And Kazakhstan, by the way, did a great job in the World Cup. One of the best opening ceremonies I've ever been to. Put it on a great show for the athletes.
Nice.
And not only was the shooting range good, but I mean, just the hospitality, everything in Kazakhstan was great. But, you know, as we're talking, these shooters are out here just going to town. It's like a normal day at the office for both of them. They're just making it look very, very easy out there. We're already in four pairs for Mosen. If Holgeen successfully hits these, that's already in four pairs. Almost a third of the way through the round.
Right. But then you've got to think about it. From here, whoever wins is going to have to go into another shoot-off.
That's correct. You're going to have to fight for the bronze medal match.
Right. And then from there,
they're
going to go into the medal matches. So
right. It's
a lot of shooting.
And I will say, you know, at some point in time, these shooters are going to get tired. You know, they've shot all day. Now they're in shoot-offs. Then they're going to have to qualify for these medal rounds. These guys aren't going to get a break. The third and fourth places of this new format does not get a zero break.
Right.
You know, they go right in from the qualification. If there is a shoot-off, they shoot off and go right into the medal round. Mosen, go ahead. He qualified here with five successfully hit pairs, walking back over to station one. So we'll see if Holgeen hits these, and then they continue to go.
I think that he's got it in him.
These guys have danced before, you know, and they both look comfortable. Holgeen's timing looks great. He looked great all day. You know, for shooting a 147, it's not an easy feat in itself.
And what is he up to, Holgeen, now? Is he just as... his life more of just focus on shooting, or is there other things going on right now?
Yeah, you know, he's been doing really well in his job. You know, his wife Lacey's at home with his son Grant. He's been kind of living the farm country life a little bit for a California boy.
Yeah.
But he's definitely nestled in, and he's doing really well as a shooter. Training where he needs to be, when he needs to be training, and winning when he needs to be winning. So
wonderful.
Absolutely. And there we have Mosen hitting his first pair again. So as they make the turn, you know, no stutter at all out of Mosen.
Oh.
And again,
thank
these.
Another,
I mean,
another
these guys could go forever. Again, these guys battled in Peru, and here they are back again. You know, it's amazing too to look at them and see how comfortable they are. For me, being an athlete, I think of myself out there and I'm almost nervous for Jeff right now a little bit. You know? And I don't feel quite this way when I'm out there. It's a little bit easier when I'm out there, I will say, but these guys are really making it look easy.
So when you're out there in a shoot-off and you're the second one to shoot, mm-hmm. you're not feeling...
You know, it's a different mindset. It can be. You know, knowing that the guy, the competitor, in this case Mosin in front of me, has successfully hit his, so I have to hit these.
Right.
That can add a little bit of a pressure on top of yourself. But again, goes back to what Mosin told me today. You know, you got to beat yourself out here. Mm-hmm. And that's what both of these guys are doing. And you can see that in their eyes, is they're worried about hitting this next pair.
What?
And they're going to continue to do that until one of them, unfortunately, falters.
Right.
I doubt at this point that they're worried about him hitting, or, you know, Jeff might have cracked one, or Mosin might have cracked one, or, wow, he's in the center of those. They're probably wishing one of them would miss at this point in time. But they will continue to do this. They will continue to do this chess game until, you know, there's not going to be a stalemate. There's going to have to be a winner. And we're already on station four. So, you know, one more station and it's already two passes, which will be two-thirds of a round of regular double strap, and they're still straight.
What?
And there we have Mosin miss one. So we'll see what happens. And now this is where the mindset comes in. So now Hoagie knows this pair moves me on.
Right.
So typically from a shooter standpoint, you're going to take a little extra breath, as he just did, you know, and then he's just going to run his routine. He's going to look the same spot he's looking, hold, and just let this one happen. Nice. And he does.
Ladies and gentlemen, that shoot-off was decided
was
on the ninth double.
That was.
Jeffrey Hoagie
really
of the USA
great job by Jeffrey Hoagie.
We'll
be moving on to the next shoot-off now.
Yes, and this next one we're going to have, I know Eller's going to be in this one. Hubert's going to be in this one for the gold medal round.
That's right.
So the shooter that wins this next shoot-off is going to go to the gold and silver, guaranteed a medal.
And there's going to be another
one that's not is going to drop down to the bronze medal match. Who's still going to have to fight for another medal. So that's where this new final format shoot-offs is really, really. So ultimately, this next shoot-off is for a medal.
Right.
This is going to buy somebody's ticket to shoot for the bronze or silver. I'm sorry, gold or silver.
Gold or silver. Right.
Whoever falters is going to go back to the bronze and have to, again, go through another test to see if he can wear a medal home or not. And he will face Hoagie.
Exactly.
In the gold medal match.
Hoagie is why I say, so nice to sit down and take a breath.
He is.
You know,
and that's a rare luxury because him going to the bronze medal match, he has to wait for these other guys to shoot off. When
right.
I was at World Cup final last year in Abu Dhabi, I literally shot off and had to walk right back out and go for a bronze medal match. And I'm not complaining because I had a chance to win a medal. But that was one of the areas that I realized that this new finals format is a different animal. I was very much tired. You know, it was warm down there, much like it is here. But just shooting all the time like that is a little bit different. And I actually misspoke a little bit. Neil is in this one. I'm sorry. This is a three-way shoot-off.
Right.
This is a three-way shoot-off for the... So the top two competitors here will go for the gold and silver. The third place finisher out of this particular shoot-off will then face Jeff Hoagie in a bronze, immediately following this shoot-off. Oh, we saw Neil, I believe, miss his first one out, which is very shocking. After only missing, I believe, three targets all day,
he
misses
amazing.
The first bird out on that first pair. But this, again, is where that new format, not allowing those competitors to see the first pair, can play a different role in this shoot-off.
Nice.
Hitting that pair now has just secured Eller a medal. He now moves on to the gold medal match.
You see that small smile come across his face.
He knew what just happened, yep. Now as we watch Hubert here, this can also buy him to secure a medal. We don't know what color yet, but this could allow him a medal. We'll see. And it does.
It does.
And it only took
so
one
second. Slovakian and Eller are going to be going on to the gold medal match. But first, you're going to tune into the bronze medal match between Neil and Hoagie.
And here's where it gets extremely interesting. So we have Neil, who shot a world record today.
Right.
And he just faltered the smallest bit in that shoot off. And now he's shooting for a bronze medal, potentially no medal,
right,
depending on what Hoagie comes up with. It's amazing, you know, looking at what the rules were to what they are now, you know, going in with maybe a couple target lead and being able to work off that lead to what it is now, not knowing your destiny.
Right.
You know, you really do. When they say you start over at zero, you really do start over at zero.
And it's really anybody's game. And then
It truly
like
is.
Said, you know, he just set a brand new world record, and none of that's coming with him.
It's not confirmed.
No.
You know, his name will be in the record book.
Right.
But he may not bring home a medal today. We will see what happens.
And this is definitely the hard one. This is a hard medal match. A bronze medal match is very difficult because one person is going home with a medal, the other person is going home in fourth place. And as we're just saying with Neil, who set a world record, he could potentially
That's right.
be going home in fourth place.
Well, we look at it. I mean, even Jeff Holguin. I mean, you know, Jeff Holguin shooting 147 today, he was one target off
right.
148. So he's one target off the world record. He beat the old world record, which was Glenn's of a 146.
Right.
But doesn't get the credit for beating world record because of Neil, which, you know, has a great shooting. You know, anybody that can shoot above a 145 on any kind of double trap range is a super, super score.
Mm-hmm.
Typically, we're seeing scores of 142, 3, and 4s getting into the finals. Those very, very top high scores. So, you know, looking at today, and we're about to announce the finalists here, it's bittersweet. You know, I have a hard time watching this. I'm proud of them both, and it's very disappointing they both can't go home.
Ladies and gentlemen,
exactly.
Now for the bronze medal match in
So we're going to be going into the bronze
Great
medal
Britain,
match
Tim
between
Neil.
Tim Neal from Great Britain.
And representing
and
the United States
going
of
up
America,
against
Jeffrey
Holguin from the United States of America.
You know, and this is a great story in itself. You have the world record holder,
Let's
new world record
the
holder,
bronze medal match.
Against the gold medal match of Tucson.
Yeah.
So it's really anyone's game at this point. Both athletes had to shoot off to get into this.
I know.
One was the victor, one faltered to this match. So, yeah. I mean, looking at both sides of the card, they're about even going into this. So now we're looking at posts 2, 3, and 4.
Mm-hmm.
They're still going to shoot 30 targets. They're going to get 2 A's, 2 B's, and a C setting on each post. Stop. It's a little bit harder to narrow these down as a shooter. You have to wait until you get your C setting or be able to memorize when I had 2 A's or 2 B's. A little bit trickier.
Oh.
We'll see how these guys unfold it in the end here.
And this is the interesting part for non-shooters. That you think, you know, non-shooters would say, okay, I'm watching this on television. I'm thinking to myself, they're out there, they're shooting. But you don't realize what's going through their mind. The
no,
mathematics
exactly.
of where am I, what's going to be coming up, and also to be able to calm yourself enough.
You're right. And I mean, not only does the shooting take enough of our mind up, but now having to remember pairs or think about the next pairs. And what you just saw there was maybe the wind, which would feel it picking up a little bit, had just set off a pair. So at some point, that's a small advantage, not intentional, as we just saw. You know, Neil saw he was getting C pair, as Holguin just saw he's getting in this B pair. That's one aspect of the double trap game that if for some reason the mics accidentally throw targets off, the next shooter will see his pair.
Not
but as we just saw, it didn't pay off.
Right.
So
right.
we just had a C sitting come out. And again, I'm one of those shooters that I don't always like to know what I'm getting.
Okay.
Sometimes it's a jinx.
Oh.
My first pass, for me personally. Holguin, it didn't bother him.
Actually, it looks like they.
And looking at Neil's scoreboard, it looks like they have credited him with that with a double hit there. So, again, from this booth, it's really hard to see the fine powder, but there are many eyes on the field, 3 judges, a referee. I'm certain they're making the right calls down there
because
nobody protested.
And it is it's a hard job to be on the ball like that and make sure you can see everything and pay complete attention to just for one chip, you know?
It is, absolutely. I mean, they're watching that. They're watching the time. They're watching to make sure the shooter's feet are in bounds. They're moving the right time. It's a very, very tough job.
So after three doubles, we have a tie between Neil and Holguin. I have a feeling this is how it could be going.
We've come all this way and we've solved nothing so far. as we can see, the gold medal match sitting there just resting. And again, that's one of the advantages. One, those guys know they're going home with medals.
Right.
And two, they get a little bit of a break. These guys are going to have to earn their medal.
And in fact, you know, Jeffrey, after going through that long shoot-off, you know, Neil, he just had one double, and then he was out.
He did, which was surprising for me, you know, coming this way. He's only missed 3 targets all day, including that one target. It's very, very difficult to game.
Mm-hmm.
You know, this is a great range, but I was surprised he missed that first one. It could have been something as simple as a bad hole pointer. You didn't see it come out that right.
Right.
But he's obviously corrected it here.
Oh.
Wait a minute.
And looking back at the scoreboard, we do see the confirmed miss on Neil. He had just mounted the gun, but I believe that's also another timeline that's in there just for the ISSF TV. They allow the announcer to announce that time. I believe Neil mounted the gun prior to that, and the ref stopped them. The mics will not turn on.
Mm-hmm.
Until they are ready for the time to be up.
Okay.
It didn't seem to falter him, though. He was fine with that pair. So So both athletes have had C on this pair, coming from a double trap mindset. So C setting now on trap post three has been handled. Both the athletes, if they're shooting my style, are going to hold for trap eight, the middle target. They know they're getting that every time from here on out.
Okay.
That may not be their style. There's a couple different styles now that work in this game, which makes it also more advantageous. And he did not. He did not hold for setter. He held for right, and he missed both targets.
You can tell it is clearly disappointing him.
He was a little bit shaken there. Yeah. And I also saw the wind. The wind did move those targets a little bit more than what they have been.
Oh.
For Holguin, I'm sure he's going to take this and try to run with it.
And I have a feeling that he is going to run with it. I have a feeling that that Jeffrey is just has gotten back into this zone of his. And it's not all shooters have this, that you can actually read them just by looking at them. But there are quite a number of shooters that you can just say, it's like almost like a key has been turned.
There is, you're right.
And
you can see Neil, I mean, he hit them targets really well, and he still had a little bit of a disgust look on his face, just briefly. He probably knew he pointed at a wrong target. Where he missed those targets. It's a tough day, you know, breaking a world record and having to really try to scrape by for this medal round.
Right.
I really feel bad for him. You know, he's shooting his best.
He has a score of 9.
Unfortunately, that's the way this game is developed.
And has a perfect score of 12. Still, anything could happen.
Holguin, having the experience from Tucson, being a long-time competitor, he's got to take advantage of this.
Absolutely.
We're going to see what the rest of the pairs deliver to us. You know, I've seen weirder things happen. But having a three-target lead going into 15 more targets, I would take that any day of the week. And it looks like Neil settled in, too, a little
bit. Yes, yep.
You know, the smallest little bit of rattle in this game can throw people off.
And how do you deal with that? I mean, are you doing training for that, mental training?
Exactly. You know, at this level, a lot of us say this is 90% mental, 10% physical when it comes down to the training. And I personally work with a psychologist out of Pittsburgh, Dan Vichoff. A lot of us have our own psychologists all across the world and the country. Any one of these finalists that said they have not been doing mental training have been lying to you.
Okay.
Or I would say the top 25 in the world. It is a vital part in this game. We have to have it.
Right.
It is so easy to focus on something else out here when you need to have a lot of your focus on these targets.
And the people that help you out, the sports psychologists or what have you, is that something that they come to the field of play and watch
Yes or and no. Sometimes I do. Sometimes you can work over the phone. Nowadays with technology, and it looks like Neil may have just let another one slip away there. So definitely not happy with himself, but my hat's off to him. I mean, breaking a world record today. He's had a really good day. Successful day. And, I know this is not what he planned for, but he's got to be happy with himself. But back to the sports psychologist, there's many ways to work with them. We work with them over the phone, over Skype, different internet apps. But we do travel quite a bit. I travel with mine probably 2, 3, 4 times a year.
No kidding.
Numerous times in the States, but European trips 2 times a year. It's that ace in the hole.
Right.
You know, whenever you need a little something else or you have a thought coming through your mind that you need help with, it's very nice to have somebody there that can help you figure it out to make sure you're giving 110% to the next pair. And as we see here today, I mean, 1 or 2 targets is the difference between meddling and not meddling.
Exactly.
So when we travel this far and spend this kind of money, spend this much time away from our family's training to come over here, every target counts. And you don't want to give up that easy.
So would you say it's 50-50 physical and mental, or would you say training I'm talking about?
You know, when you start off, when you're a younger shooter, it's definitely a little more even.
Right.
You know, you want to spend as much time physically training as you do mentally training. But once you develop the game and your hands know what to do and your eyes can tell your hands what to do, and then it starts playing games with you upstairs, you need to talk to somebody. You need to get everything figured out. And
looks like
Holguin. Yeah, he was holding for trap 9. He looked at it twice. From up here, it looked very, very faint if there was any smoke. But the score reads as a hit target. And again, from all the coaches, all the referees, I did not see any flag raised.
No, not at all.
It's confirmed it was a hit. But, once you reach the world level, and most of these countries, once you reach your national level to become selected for a lot of these teams and travel to World Cups and World Championships, you have to have a good understanding for the mental game. So, that one, I don't know if Holguin was so lucky yet. He looked at it twice.
In the bronze medal match for double trap men.
And they're moving on again. From up here again, it's a really, really hard viewing area for us to see that. But
so the leadership remains the same.
Again, there's no Neil question down there. I know from the fact that if there was not smoke, that there would be protests.
Absolutely.
Again, with a perfect score.
So I'm confident that they're doing the right calls down there on the field.
Three doubles remain.
Perfect match that he is. That he's hit all the targets, and we only have a couple more targets.
He has. We have three pair to go.
Yeah.
And he's ahead by four targets, so he's very relaxed. You know, this is potentially another gold medal for Holguin.
Right.
So we'll see what happens here. I'm sorry, bronze medal. My fault. Mm-hmm. Bronze medal.
You just have gold.
I know. That's right. I'm either first or last. You know. We saw Holguin stutter there a little bit. I don't know if this is going to cost them this match or not, but it certainly should not. Again, my hat's off to Neil. I mean, shot a great round.
He really did.
He's going to be one to watch, you know, coming up the World Championships. He's got a lot ahead of him. Points the gun very well.
Mm-hmm.
So there's no doubt here that this little falter does not mean that he was a loser by any means today.
God, no, not at all.
Ball!
And that made things a little bit interesting there. So he missed the first bird there. pressure is very high at the end, as we can see here. You know, I didn't want to say it too soon. this is still wide open here. You know, they have to earn these targets right here to the end. So, you know, this is a good message. You know, Neil, who has not given up, in fact, corrected himself quite quickly, ran the last, two passes to end with a 26 for this. If Holguin hits one of the two here, he secures it, but... You know, he went straight for passes.
Nice.
And there he secures it with a 28. So there's a bronze medal.
Bronze medalist Jeffrey Holguin from the United States of America.
Holguin is your bronze medal winner. Jeffrey Holguin of the USA.
We got Tim Neal finishing fourth.
I know.
Again, from a shooter to shooter, my hat's off to him.
Ladies and gentlemen, a new world record today, which just is really amazing. And so definitely, if anybody deserves a medal here, it is him for that.
No doubt.
Yeah.
No doubt. And, you know, we're not going to forget his name anytime soon. I'm sure he'll be around.
Not with a score that high. Every time that we see, at least on my papers, who's a world record holder, we'll see his name.
Well, I mean, he beat Glenn Ehler's world record from the World Championships.
Right.
So he can always say that. You know, that's
true.
A feat itself. I mean, anytime you beat an Olympic gold medalist for a world record on a score of a 148, it's amazing, amazing, shoot. I know he's not going to be happy. It may take him a second or two. Any shooter would be.
Yeah.
You know, a bit disgusted with himself. That's not what he wanted. You know, I'm sure he tried his best, without a doubt. Gave it all to his all. But what comes into play, what comes into my mind is this shoot-off and then going right back out. Having to just continue to chug along.
Right.
It's different. You know, a lot of us athletes, and, you know, looking at his first final, he may not have been used to that.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure he learned a ton from this, and I would be scared to face him again in his next final.
I was just going
to
say, I think I have a feeling he's going to really put up a huge fight the next time.
Absolutely.
And
I know my learning curve was in Abu Dhabi, the same as I think happened to me. You know, went in a good position, shot off, got in the bronze medal match, came out fourth.
Right.
I learned a lot. You know, came back in Tucson and did something.
Ladies and gentlemen, and
so
now
we're
going to
be moving on to the gold medal match now with USA's Glenn Ehler.
ISSF World Cup in München, 2014.
So this must be pretty nice for you right now, thinking about your teammates.
Yeah,
you guys
excited.
Already have two medals.
This
you know?
Is going to be big. So we have a shooter from Slovakia who's in his first final.
That's
versus
right.
The Olympic gold medalist. You know, all the above.
Slovakia,
huge resume.
Hubert,
I can't wait to watch this one unfold.
And we've got Hubert Olenek.
Ladies
going up
and
against
Ehler,
and we're going to get scoring pretty soon. So I'm
absolutely.
Sorry, go right ahead.
No, that's fine. I was saying both athletes look surprisingly calm and cool. You know, you have Ehler being, again, he's won every single medal in double trap, from Olympic Games, National Championships, World Cups, World Cup Finals, World Championships, most of them doubled.
Right.
Or tripled. And then we have this shooter, Hubert from Slovakia, who's in here, and he's going to battle head-to-head. He looks very calm.
He does
looks
very
calm. Cool. He shot the score to earn this.
Right.
He's going home with a medal. He has nothing to lose.
And this is what's probably going through his head right now. I've got absolutely nothing to lose. I'm just going to do my best and see what happens.
Absolutely.
You know? But Ehler, he always looks calm to me. He never looks frazzled or
he
is
does.
That the right word, frazzled?
And, no, that's fine. he's hard to beat. I mean, I work with him. We hang out a lot. I know him. I know him inside and out. We're teammates. We're best friends. He is really hard to beat.
Yeah.
When he's on his game, it's hands down. In fact, I've roomed with him here. Both shooters starting off with perfect scores here in the first pair. Rooming with him here, I could tell that, you know, he had burning desire to shoot something good here.
Right.
He was ready to get back up on top. Not that he faltered, but, you know, he shot didn't shoot the score he wanted to in Tucson. Missed the shoot off for the final by one target. And has obviously fought his way back and is making a statement here. So this is going to be a grudge match. This is going to be a fight to the end. I mean, these guys are – they have nothing else to get. They're getting it all right here.
Well, in fact, when I came down looking for you, I ran into Glenn, and he said, I'm really happy you can't ask me to commentate with you today.
That's right. We make the running joke. This is the best worst seat in the house. So if we're not out there, we'd rather be up here. And after this, we will just go home. There's an off pair that I was discussing a little bit earlier. So Glenn's holding for trap seven. Had to make that huge move over. We have so much gun speed going in. I'm certain he knows what he did.
Okay.
It's one of those, by the time we pull the trigger as an athlete, it's too late. So, and right there, Hubert just had the off pair.
That's
back
right.
Back the other side and made it look very easy. So,
after the third pair, we've got Olenek holding on to first place with a one-target advantage over Eller. Anything could happen.
That's correct. And there we see all the coaches are standing over there.
Yeah.
There's Todd Graves, the Slovakian coach is sitting over there. I mean, this is down and dirty. This is what international shooting should be like.
Exactly.
Whoa! Glenn just pointed out an off pair on that side of the field just perfectly. So, again, those off pairs can play tricks on us. We're not – coming from the old game to the new, we're not used to that large move. And there Hubert just drew a C setting. So, coming from station three, again, I would hold center bird.
Right.
We'll see what Hubert decides to do on the way through here. Everyone has their own style here, and not one's better than the other. We've proven on all these World Cups that numerous styles will work.
Mm-hmm. Whoa!
You know, and Eller already drew that C setting, so he was holding center target. He knows he's getting that trap eight for the rest of this round from station three.
So you say more likely that
may have been a miss from here. Hubert just misses as well. C setting on trap four or station four, so that evens it up. But Hubert has had two C settings, so
right.
From my perspective, that's a slight advantage on my end. Well. He can hold now center trap on station four.
Whoa!
Nice.
We already discussed who he's going against. I mean, you can throw a lot at this guy. He may not miss ever. So Eller is really tough to battle with, and that's one of the reasons why the USA double trap team has had so much success. We travel, we live together, we shoot together on a regular basis. I am shooting against Olympic medalists, Olympic team members. Today, I train against a potential gold and bronze medalist.
That's right.
So that's a huge advantage for me. You know, as well as the rest of us.
Can you tell me a little bit about what's going on in Eller's life right now?
Yeah, he's bounced back from, again, revamping his style as well. He shoots a little bit more aggressive style. He shoots a lot of birds backwards or pairs backwards. For him, I guess it's the right way.
Yeah.
He's backwards. But it works for him. You know, and he lit the world on fire the first year, him and Mosen. And struggled just a little bit in Tucson. I shouldn't use the word struggle. He missed the final by one target. And I think it led a big burning desire for him to come back.
Right.
I saw a different shooter here, and he's very determined, I believe, already on the Olympics, looking forward. Once you win everything, I mean, what else is there to do? You know, and I think to myself a lot of times, how do these guys get motivated to come out here and shoot and just work? And that's what they're doing right now is they're working hard. I mean, this part isn't fun. You know, when they hang the medals around their neck,
that's
it's fun.
That's nice.
So right now these guys are working. And all the training that went into this and the travel.
Right.
And the time away from families and friends. So.
And that's tough. You know, I know you've got children at home. And,
exactly.
You know, it can't be easy to be away from home all the time.
We're gone 120, 140 days a year on average.
It's a lot.
It is.
Yep.
And then not to mention we're supposed to try to compete and win against the best in the world.
Whoa.
So it's not an easy job by any means. Stop. Broke the backside of that one off. And that was the off pair that he missed this previously. He figured that one out. Going on to Hubert. That one also, he had the same exact off pair, but we're tied up.
We are definitely tied up. This is after nine doubles, 17-17, Eller and Olenek. And they both look like they have no intentions of budging or backing down.
No, they're not going to give this one away.
For a while.
Absolutely not. And a lot of pairs have been given up. You know, both shooters have had some C setting on different pairs, different stations. So we have eliminated some pairs. It's going to become more comfortable for him here at the end, although the pressure is going to get higher.
Right.
So we'll see how that unfolds,
Now, you said that you train with Eller, also Holguin.
Yes.
And how often do you get together to train? Do you do it every day when you're at home?
Well, we work together in the U.S. Army Marksmanship Unit at Fort Benning, Georgia. So we report to work 5 days a week. So we have the opportunity to train every day we're at work together.
That's wonderful.
It is. It's a great equation. You know, we all molded together quite well back in the 2005-2006 time frame. Bill Kiever, who was a longtime shooter, actually recruited a lot of us to come on this team and molded this partnership, I guess is the best way to put it, to we all had similar goals, we all had similar abilities, and when you put that all together, as you can see many countries do this, you know, Russia, China, a lot of these countries have come together and created teams and family-based training camps to where when you're together and you're pushing each other, then coming out here and shooting is not, it's just like everyday. So that's one of the strengths that we have. And, you know, and working with these guys at Fort Benning and, you know, the U.S. Army helping us out and just doing all they can and allowing us to do this is just, it's a God-given gift and true honor.
Wouldn't you call yourselves the Awesome Threesome or something like that?
You know, we used to be called the Four Horsemen, and then, you know, Bill Cooper got out, so we don't know what we're going to call the three of us.
Dream Team or Awesome Threesome, I think sounds pretty good.
Yeah, that may fit. We'll see. We'll see after Rio what happens. But, you know, as we're talking, these guys are out there just chugging away. And
is that a miss there?
I may have spoke too soon. We're looking at I didn't see any of the referees raise their hand. But, you know, from a shooter's standpoint, anytime you draw a little bit of powder off of a target, you kind of take a deep sigh.
I bet you do. Oh, thank God.
Glad that came out. And not always, but most of the time. You know, from my perspective, if you typically skin a target or just draw a little bit of powder, it's because you weren't 100% on it.
Right.
And a rifle shooter, we just shot a 6 when we need a 10. So a couple of different things. You know, you can also work that to your advantage. If you know you were maybe behind the target or over the target, you can adjust that for your next pair. Or you may not know where you're at. And you've just lost a lot of confidence going into your next couple of pairs.
All right, these are the last three pairs and the first pair for both.
Two more pairs, and we're going to see more shoot-offs.
Exactly.
So we'll see what happens here.
It's really nice. The lighting has not really changed at all, even though it's getting later out.
It really hasn't.
It's
you know,
really nice.
Typically, we deal with clouds, with sun, with horizons. Everything has been the same, and you can see Eller with a bit of frustration there. Knew he was getting that pair, maybe shot a little quick. I know he wishes he could have that one back.
I'm sure that he does.
Without a doubt. If we asked him right now where he shot on it, he would tell us. But that puts some pressure on Hubert.
That's true.
We're going to see what happens here. We have one pair left. We have two shots after this whole marathon these guys have ran to decide what color medal this is.
Whoa.
Okay, two more pairs to, I mean, one more double to go.
One more pair for Hubert. Yes. Eller definitely put the pressure on him. I mean, he's going to have to break both of these to win, miss one tie, and he kills them both.
And he kills them both, and there is our gold medal. Unbelievable. Very excited. He worked very hard for this gold, without a doubt.
He finally shows some expression.
Exactly.
You can see his coach coming out there. They are very, very happy. It's been a long, hard-fought day for him.
It sure has. Gold medalist Hubert Olenek. And let's see if we can take a look at our silver medalist as well. There he is, silver medalist from the United States of America, Glenn Eller.
There he is, and he's talking to the referee about something. I'm not sure what happened down there from up here, but something may have happened out there. They're deciphering something. I don't think it will change the results, but something may have gotten his way. We'll find that out later.
We certainly will. Let's hold on just for a couple minutes here just to see if anything does transpire of this. But, God, Josh, it was so nice to have you here next to me.
It was a lot of fun. I was hoping for some more shoot-offs.
Me too.
They were trying to light it up for us.
It definitely was. I wish you the best of luck in the future. And
thank you so
much. Also, enjoy your family at home and take really good care of yourself.
Thank you so much. I hope to see you in Spain, but from a different angle.
Absolutely.
I hope to see you down front.
How about for an interview instead?
Absolutely.
Okay, thank you, Josh.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the athletes for the medal ceremony for the ISSF World Cup Munich 2014. The medal winners for the double trap men event.
Ladies and gentlemen,
medals will be presented by Herr Maximilian Löffler of Germany, the chairman of the ISSF shotgun jury. And your bronze medal winner representing the United States of America, Jeffrey Hogeen.
So, congratulations, Jeffrey.
Thanks, sir. Appreciate it.
That's something, some special yes. Food from here.
I'm looking forward to it. Okay? Nice.
And your silver medal winner representing the United States of America, Walton Eller.
So, Walton, bend over, please. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Very, very good performance.
Thank you.
Some special food.
Okay.
And your gold medal winner for the Double Trap Men event here at the ISSF World Cup Munich 2014, representing Slovakia, Hubert Olenik.
Hubert, congratulations.
Thank you very,
very
much.
Very, very good performance.
Thank you very much.
Have some food, please.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, now have some food.
Ladies and gentlemen, please show your respect for the national anthem of Slovakia. Now take a few moments to have some photographs.
Thank you.